Welcome, class 10 students. So we have seen how Bassanio has chosen the lead casket and expecting that the consequence, the result will be joyful for him. In the meantime, Portia, who has been standing there witnessing all along while he is making the choice, and she was having all sort of negative emotions, negative feelings that what will happen if he chooses the wrong casket. So now Portia is feeling elated. She is feeling very happy, very ecstatic. And so she remarks, she's speaking to herself, how all the other emotions, passions fleet to air as doubtful thoughts and rash embrace despair and shuddering fear and green-eyed jealousy. O love, be moderate, allay thy ecstasy, in measure rein thy joy, scan this excess, I feel too much of thy blessing, make it less, for fear I surfeit. So see how Portia cannot contain her joy, and she's remarking to herself how all other emotions fleet to air as doubtful thoughts, rash embrace, despair, shuddering fear and green-eyed jealousy. She says, how now, when Bassanio has chosen the lead casket, she feels that she is so happy that, of course, they will now belong to each other, that all the other passions, all the emotions she was witnessing until now, the negative feelings, they seem to vanish into thin air. And what were the emotions, the negative emotions she was feeling? Doubtful thoughts. She was doubting in her mind. Rash embraced despair. Quickly embraced, quickly accepted despair, hopelessness. Shuddering fear, frightening fear. Green-eyed jealousy. She was feeling jealous. The green color, the green-eyed monster is known. This is personification, and jealousy is personified or compared to a green-eyed monster even now, even today, even in those days. And so she says, this green-eyed monster also seems to vanish into thin air as soon as now Bassanio has chosen the casket in where a portrait is contained. Oh, love, be moderate. Now she's exclaiming to love that, please, be moderate. Come to me in moderation. Allay thy ecstasy. Lessen thy joy. Lessen thy joyfulness to me. This happiness to me, this blessing to me. In measure, rein thy joy. Scan this excess. She says, let this excess of joy come to me like a rain, like a shower of rain, gentle rain, drizzle. Scan this excess, and it should come to me in moderation. Lessen this excess of joy, lest I will not, because she says she will not be able to handle it. So much of joy altogether, she might not be able to handle. So let it come to me in moderation, in small quantities. I feel too much thy blessing, make it less. For fear I surfeit, she says, this is too much of a blessing, love, that I am witnessing or I am feeling, because I fear that I will not be able to handle so much of your blessing. This also can be related to Nerissa's speech in Act 1, Scene 2, Children, when Nerissa says, it is no mean happiness to be seated in the mean. Where she means, when she was consoling Portia, who was very sad at that time, telling her that a person who is overfed or a person who is starved, both of them are equally sick. So what she means to say, that excess or to have less, both are bad. So that is what Portia means to say, that excess of everything is bad. So love, come to me in moderation. So much of blessing, of your blessing, I will not be able to handle. So she is feeling extremely joyous, extremely happy. Now in the meantime, Bassanio, who has opened the casket now, and he remarks, what do I find here? He opens the leaden casket, and now, of course, as it is expected by all of us, he finds the portrait of Portia inside. He remarks, fair Portia's counterfeit. Counterfeit means portrait, picture. Then he is mesmerized by the beautiful picture of Portia, which he finds inside the leaden casket, because it is so beautiful. He cannot take his eyes away from the picture. He exclaims, what demigod hath come so near creation? He is praising the painter, the artist who has painted this picture of Portia. He says, he is nearly a demigod, nearly a god. who has come to paint so beautiful a picture of Portia that it comes to be, it seems to be so real like Portia. Move these eyes, or whether riding on the balls of mine, seem they in motion? Then he says, it seems as if the eyes of Portia are moving, the eyeballs of Portia are moving. Then he exclaims, or whether because they are fixed on my balls of my eyes, on my eyes, maybe they seem to be in motion, maybe because as my eyes are moving, so they seem to be moving along with my eyes. Then he comes to the lips. Here are the severed lips, parted with sugar breath. So sweet a bar should sunder such sweet friends. He says, then look at her lips, which are separated from each other. And how are they parted? They are parted with sugar breath. It seems to him, he can even feel as if sweet breath, he can feel, is coming out from between the two lips. And he exclaims, so sweet a bar should sunder such sweet friends. Of course, it is only befitting that such a sweet barrier should come between so sweet two sweet friends. That is, that lips, between the lips, only sugar breath, sweet breath, which is coming out, can part them. Here in her ears, the painter plays the spider and hath woven a golden mesh to entrap the hearts of men faster than gnats and cobwebs. Then he comes to the hair of Portia. He says, in the hair, the painter, so this is a metaphor, he's comparing the painter to the spider. And see, he says, just like a spider weaves a cobweb in order to trap insects in them quickly, in the same way, the painter has woven such a beautiful golden color mesh, a web of Portia's hair, that the hearts of men will be caught in it more quickly than gnats are caught in the web of a spider. Then again he comes back to the eyes. He finds the eyes most attractive in the picture. He says, but her eyes, how could he see to do them? He says, how could the painter see the eyes in order to paint them so beautifully? Because he says, having made one, methinks it should have power to steal both his and leave itself unfurnished. He says, because I think after painting one eye, the painter would have been blinded by the power of the beautiful eye, that he would have left the second eye unfinished. Yet look how far the substance of my praise doth wrong this shadow in enterprising it. So far this shadow doth limp behind the substance. He says, yet though I am praising this picture of Portia, this shadow of Portia, this portrait of Portia so much, yet I am not able to praise it properly because I seem to do injustice to it. I am underestimating it. In the same way, just like this shadow of Portia is nothing in front of the real Portia. The real Portia is far more beautiful than this picture. Then he comes to the scroll. He moves his eyes away from the picture and he finds the scroll over there. Just like there were scrolls, you remember, in the previous two caskets also, the gold casket as well as the silver casket, where the Prince of Morocco and the Prince of Aragon also find scrolls in the caskets, in the two caskets respectively. He also finds a scroll in the lead casket. He says, here's a scroll. That is a folded piece of a paper rolled. He says, the scroll, the continent and summary of my fortune. He says, let me read what is written, because it contains and summarizes what lies in my future. How fortunate I am. And he reads. So of course, it is something which has been written by Portia's father when he was alive, addressing to anyone who is going to choose the lead casket. And so it is a compliment to the person who is going to choose this casket, of course. So it is complimentary for Bassanio. He reads loudly. You that choose not by the view, chance as fair and choose as true. Since this fortune falls on you, be content and seek no new. If you be well pleased with this and hold your fortune for your bliss, turn you where your lady is and claim her with a loving kiss. So the compliment in it is that you, addressing the person who is reading, that is Bassanio now, that you who choose not by the outward appearance, you who have chosen not by the outward appearance, chance as fair and choose as true. May you always May you have a good fortune as like this always, and may you choose as you have chosen rightly. You always choose rightly as you have chosen now. Since this fortune falls on you, this fortune means this fortune of winning Portia comes to you now. So be content, you should be satisfied now, and you should seek no further. You should not seek any further now to try your fortune. You should be satisfied with what you have got. If you be well pleased with this and hold your fortune for your bliss, and if you are really satisfied and happy with what you have got, and you hold your luck and you think that you are lucky enough for this blessing, then turn you where your lady is. Then turn towards your lady love whom you have won. Claim her with your loving kiss and claim her to be your, to be yours by planting a kiss on her lips. So of course then he looks up and he says a gentle scroll, and then he moves towards Portia. Fair lady, by your leave, and kisses her. By your permission, he says, by your permission, and he kisses her. Then he says, I come by note to give and to receive, that I have come to you to give this kiss according to the instructions which is given in this scroll, to give and receive a kiss from you, to claim you to be mine. Then he speaks. He's still dazed. He's still not real. He is still doubting whether he has really won the contest of selecting the right casket or not, whether he really has won over Portia. He says, he's exclaiming to all, to Portia, like one of two contending in a prize, that thinks he had done well in people's eyes. Hearing applause and universal shout, giddy in spirit, still gazing in a doubt whether these peals of praise be his or no. He says, my condition is like that of one of those two contenders who are competing for a prize in a competition, those who are fighting for a prize in a competition, that thinks he hath done in well in people's eyes. So my condition is like that of one of those contenders who has won the match, who has won the competition, and he is still looking towards the people, whether, because he's hearing the applause, he's hearing the cheering of the people together. People are shouting, clapping, cheering for him. So he is still doubtful whether these cheers, whether these universal shout, whether the people are together applauding, it is the applauds are for him or not. Giddy in spirit, still gazing in a doubt. He says, I'm still dazed, I'm still doubtful, and I'm looking all around whether these shouts, these peals of praise are for me or not. So thrice, fair lady, stand I even so. So he's praising Portia, that you lady who is three times more beautiful than what I speak, my condition is like that one of the two competitors, and I stand here as doubtful whether I see be true until confirmed, signed, ratified be by you. He says, so my condition is like that of one of those two contenders, because I'm still doubtful whether what I am seeing is really true or not, until and unless you confirm it, until and unless you validate it and sign for me and tell me that yes, it is true, I have won the correct casket and chosen you for my wife. Tell here, children, go through this, try to understand and do the extracts in your workbook related till here. Okay, then till my next video. Goodbye.